okay, let's get into the changes in section B, water services. We will look at all parts of the water services, parts B1, cold water, B2, heated water, part B3, non-drinking water services, part B4, firefighting water services, part B5, cross-connection control, parts B6 and B7, rainwater services and rainwater storage. And I was also going into some detail on the new specification 41, the new deemed to satisfy for backflow prevention hazard identification. As you all know, plumbing codes evolve and they need to be kept updated so they maintain pace with industry trends and product innovation. When we started to review PCA 2019, we were hit with a number of areas that required work. In part B1, cold water services, we look at things like plumbing in a bushfire area, how the PCA interacts with the FPAA 101D requirements around residential fire sprinklers, water efficiency provisions, rainwater top-up lines, etc. Plus the other items that keep the code relevant to the requirements of a modern world. Three areas of change in 2022 require specific attention here today. These are water efficiency clause B1D2, plumbing in bushfire prone areas clause B1D4, and FPAA 101D for the sprinklers clause B1D5. Water efficiency B1D2. I know there is a lot on this slide, but it is important to go over this with you. Here you will again see the provision numbering, B in the section, 1 in the section number, D the type of provision, being a deemed to satisfy provision, and 2 being a provision clause number. Okay, but let's talk about that provision. The water efficiency requirements that have now been aligned with the WELS star ratings. WELS is the Water Efficiency Labelling and Standards Scheme that I am sure you'll know about. This will make it easier for practitioners to identify products compliant to the water efficiency requirements of the PCA. There is no longer any need to test the flows or look for the flow rate data on the product. If it has a WELS rating and falls in line with the DTS, you're good to go. This is important to note that there has not been any efficiency increases in water efficiency in this code. This is a new DTS for 2022. This reference to AS 3959 for plumbing in bushfire prone areas has been added to highlight that there are specific differences for building and plumbing in these areas. The requirements for compliance with AS 3959 are determined by the bushfire attack levels, or BAL. This is a method for rating the intensity of a location's potential exposure to bushfire. This standard will now be referenced in both the BCA and the PCA to ensure consistency in the solutions and regulations in bushfire-prone areas. In respect to plumbing in a cold water service, this standard encompasses areas for consideration that include materials and installation criteria. This is another new DTS provision for 2022. B1D5 sees the relocation of the reference to FPAA 101D from the firefighting water services, part B4, to the cold water services. This is to better align with the requirements of the system due to the fact that it is connected to the drinking water supply. We are starting to see an increase in this method of construction and installing sprinklers in class 2 and 3 buildings. And as most of you know, this fire sprinkler system uses a separate drinking water line to feed the sprinkler heads and the toilets. This aspect meant it was more suited to be covered in the cold water service part of the PCA and not the firefighting services section, which are not regulated by plumbing regulators in each state or territory. Now on to part B2, heated water services. I will touch on 4 areas of change in part B2, heated water services in this section. 1, you'll see that the water efficiency requirements have been aligned with the WELS ratings here too. This will make it easier for practitioners to identify products compliant to the water efficiency requirements of the PCA. Again, it is important to note that there has not been an increase in stringency for water efficiency. 2 is minor changes to the heated water energy efficiency requirements. However, the state and territory variations need to be consulted to ensure that the local requirements are taken into consideration. 3, explanatory information has been included as guidance material for heated water services. This information is based on a research study into scalding events and prompted by the states and territory regulators The simple suggestions provided in the PCA are expected to go a long way to reducing the likelihood of scalding incidents occurring from heated tap water. And number four is the additional clarity provided on the application of heated water temperature control requirements. As different jurisdictions have different triggers, the national content of the PCA has been clarified, and any variation to this approach is now clearly outlined in the state appendix. I apologise for the wordiness of this slide, and there are just too many words here to follow, but it is all about the reducing or preventing scalding of the in the bath or shower. I've copied across the clause directly from the PCA so you can see how explanatory information boxes like this look in the code. This explanatory information provides guidance on types of taps, mix of levers, the positioning, the height, the location positioning, and the use of recesses. This work was prompted by a report by the Burns Registry of Australia and New Zealand that identified 80% of all scalds were in the bath or shower. This slide shows that 80% of scald injuries happen when bathing, that is from the bath or shower. Nothing comes close, and this is why it was so important to protect the consumer through the PCA. When we saw this data, it was like a sledgehammer hitting us. We state in the PCA that the objective of the part is to safeguard people from illness, injury or loss, including loss of amenity, due to a failure of a heated water installation, and ensure that the heated water installation is suitable. The amount of illness, injury and loss that heated water scalding inflicts meant changes were needed. This slide tells a good story as well. When bath and shower hot water scalds, it is all about the age of the person. This slide from the report shows that people between the ages of 6 and 50 generally can get out of the way. But either side of that, they cannot quickly enough, so this is what the provision is all about. We know people don't like to be micromanaged or nanny-stated, but we have to acknowledge that there are some members of society that are not aware of the dangers present. This then leads me into the next slide, B2D5, maximum delivery temperature. Along with the guidance information around tap locations, etc., changes have been made to the temperature of delivered heated water at the outlet of each sanitary fixture. The big thing to note in this provision is being a DTS, it stipulates specific temperatures for specific installations, not more than 45 degrees C in A, and not more than 50 degrees C elsewhere. You'll also note that this provision is for heated water installations for personal hygiene. So if hotter water is wanted in the laundry or kitchen, it's still available. Again, though, check with any state and territory variation that may apply in your region. We have also added some supporting additional explanatory information for clarity on this slide. And this explanatory information in the provisions gives some clarity and guidance around scenarios covered in B2D5 on the last slide, and may include installations shown in this slide. Another area for thought is that consideration should be given to the intended occupants of the building when commissioning the heated water delivery temperature. For example, if the occupants of a Class 1 building are older adults or young children, a lower temperature than specified in B2D5 could or should be considered. I would like to let the audience know that the work on scald prevention done by the ABC office and the Plumbing Codes Committee has attained international recognition, and many hospitals and birds agencies around the world have cited the work done by the ABC as integral steps in reducing tap water scalding. It sort of makes you feel good that you really make an impact to keep Australians safe in the bathroom. Leaving heated water now, we move on to part B3, non-drinking water. A non-drinking water service must not be connected to any outlet that supplies water for A, human consumption, B, food preparation, C, food utensil washing, or D, personal hygiene. It still must comply with the water efficiency requirements similar to a cold water service, as it may service toilet systems. The performance requirements in this part has been expanded for 2022 to include more performance requirements aspects, and these include water velocity, identification of pipes, access and location, pressure delivery, and how the system must be designed to limit uncontrolled discharge. Moving on to part B4, firefighting water services, There have been a few changes to the firefighting water services part of this section. However, they aren't expected to change the way practitioners are currently working. These are more clarification amendments, as the solutions and reference documents used for firefighting water services were always available. But now it is clear what systems can be used by directly referencing them in Volume 3. At this point is probably a good time to stop and use firefighting water services as an example of the relationship between the Building Code of Australia and the Plumbing Code of Australia. A key thing to remember is that NCC Volumes 1 and 2 will outline when a firefighting water service is required, but NCC Volume 3 provides the solutions how these systems are to be installed. And in this example, you can see how the DTS references the applicable standards. It was important to expand on the provisions around fire sprinkler systems, as it provides greater access for the practitioner to the requirements. By elevating the specific standards into the DTS, greater direction is provided. This is the same with fire hydrants, hose reels, and firefighting water services in bushfire-prone areas, all new for 2022. Although the service work is usually not regulated by plumbing regulators, plumbers generally do a lot of this work. Well, enough of the fun stuff. Let's keep moving. On to Part B6, Rainwater Services. The rainwater harvesting and use part of NCC 2019 has been split into two parts in NCC 2022. One part pertaining to rainwater services and one to rainwater storage. There hasn't been any technical changes to the provisions of these parts from NCC 2019. However, this has been a significant formatting change by splitting it into two parts. Generally, the code considers that where the drinking water is provided by a network utility operator, a rainwater service is a service provided for non-drinking purposes, such as toilet flushing and garden taps. In rural areas where rainwater is the only source of water and is used for drinking, this is a cold water service. Additional clarity has also been provided through the introductions to each part. And another important section here is that the backflow provisions for rainwater tanks remain as per 2019. But we're expecting to do a full review of this for NCC 2025. Another point is that this part does not apply to rainwater used for irrigation purposes. And it is important to note that where water provided by a network utility operator is not available, or not utilised as a primary water source for drinking and personal hygiene, roof-collected rainwater is considered to be a cold water service supplied by an alternative source and must comply to the provisions of the cold water service. Part B7, rainwater storage. This part applies from the point of entry of the rainwater to the rainwater storage to the point of connection to the cold or rainwater service as applicable. As outlined on the previous slide, where a network utility operator supply is not available, it applies to the storage of water intended for drinking and personal hygiene, used as an alternative water source supplying a cold water service.